We are so blessed that God is here, because when two or three are gathered, it's in the Bible that God is here right now. Amen. This is the holy ground. We want to praise Him with psalms and songs. It's a blessed time to be able to praise Him and give Him all the glory. It's not all about us. It's all about Jesus. That's why we're here, yeah? Pastor Ben was to give us a good message today. And I hope everyone will be transformed with the message. But right now, if you feel like standing up, I want to stand up. Okay. And we'll just bless His name. Amen. Yes. Let's do it. Blessed be Your name in the land that is plentiful, where Your streams of abundance flow. Blessed be Your name. Blessed be Your name when I'm found in the desert place. Though I walk through the wilderness, blessed be Your name. Every blessing You pour out, I turn back to praise.
Yes, Lord.
When the darkness closes in, Lord, still the Lord, blessed be Your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be Your glorious name. Blessed be Your name when the sun's shining down on me, when the world's still as it should be. Blessed be Your name. Blessed be Your name on the road marked with suffering. The pain in the offering, blessed be Your name.
Listen, declare it. Every blessing,
every blessing You pour out, I turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say,
blessed be Your glorious name.
You give and take away. He gives. Is the only God that we can worship. There's no other God like Him and Him alone. Amen. There is none like You. No one else can touch my heart like You do. I can search for all eternity, Lord. There is none like You. Let's sing it, everyone. There is none like You. No one else can touch my heart like You do. I can search for all eternity, Lord. Your mercies flows like the rivers so wide, and healing comes from Your hand. Suffering children are safe in Your arms. There is none like You. There is none like You. No one else can touch my heart like You do. I can search for all eternity, Lord, and find there is none. Your mercy flows like a river so wide, and healing comes from Your hand. Suffering children are safe in Your arms. There is none. There is none like You. No one else can touch
Praise God. I'm so glad you're here. Are you ready to get in the word of the Lord? Because I know the Holy Spirit is here, and he's wanting to teach you. He's wanting to show you how to live a life that is truly blessed. All you got to do is follow his word. Amen. Trust in him, and you're going to see the blessings come forth in your life. Why don't we go ahead? Let's start off with a word of prayer. Let's come before our Father in heaven. Let's pray. Father God, we just want to thank you, Lord, for this time as we know our minds and hearts are fully surrendered to you. I pray you will have your way, Father. Speak to us in such ways, Father, that we know we're not going to leave here the same person. We know as your word comes and touch our minds and touch our hearts, and we choose to live according to your word, we're becoming more like your son, Jesus Christ. So, Father, we give this time fully into your hands. We come to love you. We come to praise you. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we all pray these things. And all my brothers and sisters, we say together, amen. Praise God. Praise God. Well, if you take a look at your notes, today the title of the sermon is Choosing What? Wisely. How to make the right choices in life. As you all probably know, right, next week is the national presidential election. Wow, that's going to be on what? Tuesday, right? And a lot of people believe, right, depending on who the winning candidate is, it will determine the fate of our country. And a lot of people believe it's going to be all good or all bad, depending on who the candidate is that will win. And, you know, I already casted my ballot on Thursday because they had the early voting, right? But I have heard people say that if their candidate wins, there's going to be great prosperity and blessings for our country. But if their candidate loses, I've heard they say this, we are doomed. And it's on both sides where I heard people say this, depending on who you will support as your candidate. I even heard people say, hey, if my candidate loses, I'm moving to another country. And they're serious about this, right? And sometimes in life, right, we're faced with a lot of choices. Many choices that could steer our lives one way or the other. It could be leading us to greater blessings or greater cursings, okay? And of course, who wants to be blessed in life? We all do, right? But we got to make sure we choose correctly, that we choose wisely, okay? And we know some choices are pretty easy, while some may be a little more difficult or challenging. But we know as Christians, what do we have that will help us, that will guide us? We have what? The Bible, right? We have the Word of God, which provides us with wisdom to make wise choices. Because let me tell you, if you're a Christian and you don't touch your Bible, you never open it up, you never read it, where are you going to get your wisdom from? The fact of the matter is God has given us this very book so that we will know how to live this life here on this planet Earth, okay? And you know, it's up to you whether you read or not, but you're either going to have a life of great joy or you're going to have a life of misery, because guess what? You don't follow what the Word of God says, yeah, it ain't going to be good. You're going to have a lot of misery in your life. And today we're going to look at 5 biblical principles to help us make decisions that will honor God and bring peace and purpose to our life. So look at that question there. First question, it says, what can we do to continually make the right choices in our lives? What does it say there? Number one, we must seek God first in all things. Let me ask you, do you see God first? When you are encountering a situation, a problem, a difficulty, right? Who do you go first? Well, sometimes you go to our relatives, our family, right? Our friends, or, you know, sometimes our spouses. And the thing is, you can go to God first. And the way you do that is you grab your Bible and you ask the Holy Spirit, speak to me, Lord, because I'm confused. I don't know what to do right now. And so you must go to God first, okay? And you can go to anybody else after that, but you know what? Go to the Lord first, amen? Look what it says here in Matthew 6, 33 to 34. I want you to read that with me, ready? Go. But seek first his kingdom and his what? His righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. I got to tell you, when I actually go to God first, the proof is in the pudding, you could say, right? That I knew I had gone to God, because if I go to God first, suddenly the anxiety and the worry becomes lessened. And I realize God is speaking to me. God is showing me what I need to do to make things better for my life. And I'm going to tell you, this is something that is so real. But you must go to God first, okay? Because if you go to anybody else first, right? I mean, they could give you good advice, especially if they are another believer, right? But why not go to the Holy Spirit first? Because you know what? Is his ways perfect? Well, is there anybody else on this planet Earth that could say that, oh, I'm perfect too? Because if you say you're perfect, guess what? You don't need God. Because you could be seen as God too, because there's only one that is perfect, and that is God. That is our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? And I got to tell you, whenever I make decisions on my own, I just got to tell you, I've seen that in my life many times where I forget to pray, I forget to go to God, and guess what happens? I have a huge tendency to make a lot of mistakes, a lot of errors, because I didn't go to him, sought counsel from everybody else except God. And I realized, man, when I do that, you know, people, sometimes they have mixed opinions, right? They can say, oh, you have to do this. Oh, God told me to tell you to do this. Well, the question is, how do you know that for sure? Why not let it be you that go to the Holy Spirit first? And you seek him. That way you will know. You don't have to go to everyone else first. You go to God first. And when I turn to God for his wisdom from his word and seek his counsel through prayer, I got to tell you, every single time, God, he guides me. He directs me. And I know the worst of the difficulties that I may be facing, guess what? He's showing me, Ben, take this step. Ben, do this. It's like, I know he's the one who's directing me. He's showing me exactly what I need to do so that I don't have to be in a position of great misery, all right? So, you know what? We can think of God and his word as our compass. And in many cases, right, a compass can be much better than a GPS, okay? And you know, because here's the thing. If you're lost in a forest, can a GPS help you find your way? Usually not, right? Because GPS, you got to, you know, tell them where you want to go, and you got to, they tell you, okay, turn left on Smith Street, and then you go. But you don't need to do this with a compass. The compass, if you know how to use it, will point you in the right direction wherever you are. And you got to know how to use it, though, right? And I got to tell you, that is why Boy Scouts, they learn how to use a compass before they can move up to the next level of survival training. This is key for the Boy Scout, because they go out into the forest. And if they don't know how to use that compass, oh, they're going to get lost. That's why they make sure everyone has a compass, because if one person loses it, right, still somebody else has it. But they will find their way if they have this compass, because without it, they may never be able to find their way home. And sometimes they will end up somewhere they don't want to be, all right? And in the same way, you got to understand, God guides us when we seek him first. And he gives us clarity. He gives us direction that will help us to make the right choices. Because Yeah, sometimes we think we know the answer. But come on. Truth be told, right? Sometimes we do it ourselves and we're in a deeper pit of kimchi. Okay? And it burns, it hurts, and we're like, how did I get here, Lord? And we realize, no, you got to turn to the Word of God, because the Word of God is perfect. He will not mislead you. He will show you what you need to do. If you follow Him, you listen for His voice, you're going to have great clarity. And you know what? You will more than just survive, you know, because the Boy Scouts, that's what the whole thing about it is, right? To teach you how to survive. But you know what? You do it God's way, you're not just going to survive. You're going to thrive. Amen? And when you know that God is leading you, you're going to see all the resources that you need. It will come in great abundance. I've seen this in my life many a time. It's when I trusted in God. He will provide exactly what you need. And, oh man, He just showers you with all that you need so that you will experience His goodness. Amen? I want you to look at what it says here in Psalm 32, verses 8 to 9. Look what it says there. Read it with me. Ready? Go. I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will counsel you with my loving eye on you. Do not be like the horse or mule, which have no understanding, but must be controlled by bit and bridle, or they will not come to you. Okay, this is God talking to the people of Israel. Well, guess what? He's also talking to us. He loves to instruct us and teach us in the way we should go. But you have to want to obey. Okay? It tells us, I will counsel you with my what? My loving eye. Not just His eye, His loving eye. And if you ever seen how a father or mother looks at their baby child, right? You can see so much love coming out of their eyes, you know? It's because, they have such great affection for this child. And the same with us. When God looks at us, He looks at us with a loving eye. And look what it says there. God says, do not be like the horse or the what? Or the mule. Because what reputation does a mule have? Stubborn, right? Stubborn as a mule, right? As they would say. That means they don't want to, you know, do things your way. Everything got to be my way, right? And for the case with the people of Israel, they became stubborn. And they chose to do things their own way. And they didn't want to follow God anymore. That's why they were in such a situation of great sorrow and misery, all right? But realize when God watches over us, He's there to protect us. He's there to comfort us. He's there to provide us with whatever we need. Amen? All right, so let's look at number two. How else can we make the right choices? Well, look at number two here. It says, always consider the what? The consequences of what? Your choices. Because what it says here. Look what Paul tells us in Galatians chapter 6, verses 7 through 8. Read it with me. Ready? Go. Don't be misled. You cannot mock the justice of God. You will always harvest what you plant. Those who live only to satisfy their own sinful nature will harvest decay and death from that sinful nature. But those who live to please the Spirit will harvest everlasting life from the Spirit. And you know what? As another translation says, right? You reap what you what? You sow. Okay, what you put in, what you go and get. Right? Just think about making decisions in your life as being like planting seeds, you know? Think about this. If a farmer plants apple seeds, what will he get? What kind of fruit will he get? Apples, right? You know, it's not that he will expect oranges. He can pray, oh, Lord, you know, I planted apple seeds, but hey, I really like some oranges on this tree instead. He can pray all he wants. Will the seed ever produce oranges? No, it ain't going to happen. So we realize what you put in, what you're going to get. And so we cannot blame God when things don't turn out our way, because You don't want to put the seed in the ground, right? And so we got to realize, yeah, we're going to reap what we sow, all right? And so, you know, each choice we make is like planting a seed. You know, good seeds produce good fruit, while bad seeds, they're going to produce bad fruit, okay? And so before making a decision, you got to consider what kind of fruit it might bear, because you got to look ahead. Because, yeah, it looks like an ordinary seed, but think in your mind, what will it produce? And where did you get your seed, okay? Because sometimes you can get inferior seeds. You got to get the high-quality ones, right? And so we got to think long-term. What will this seed produce? And we got to ask ourselves, what will this choice more likely lead to? Will it bring forth peace, joy, and life? Or will it bring forth misery and regret? And a lot of people who don't look ahead, right, they find themselves in a situation where there's a lot of grief, you know, a lot of misery, and go, how did this happen? But they didn't think ahead. They did something and didn't think about what the consequences would be. And making decisions with the future in mind can help us to avoid a harvest of regret. Because a lot of times people, they make the wrong choices. They live a life of total regret. Why did I do that? Oh, I shouldn't have done that. Oh, I should have thought ahead. Yeah, you all should. Amen? Gotta think ahead. What will, you know, bring forth, what will come forth as I choose to do this very thing? And, you know, I gotta tell you, one day a mother explained to her 5-year-old daughter that if she chooses to disobey her, she would have to live She told her 5-year-old daughter that if she chooses to disobey her, she would have to live with the consequences, okay? And the little girl, she responded by saying, oh, mommy, she had a terrified look on her face. And she said, oh, mommy, please don't let me live with the consequences. I want to live here with you. So in her mind, she's thinking the consequences are a family, okay? So that's what she said. Don't let me live with the consequences. I want to live here with you. And we realize when we don't choose to obey the Lord, when we choose to do things the way we want it, yeah, we're going to have to live with the consequences, all right? In other words, what's going to happen, going to happen. And you got no one to blame but who? But yourself. And we realize this is so true. You can just think about in your life, you know, your lifetime where you made all these choices and you made reckless choices and you didn't think it through. Yeah, more than likely, you're going to experience something that is going to bring forth a lot of discomfort. All right? So it's good to think things through first. I want you to look what it says here in Isaiah chapter 57, verses 19 to 21. Look what it says here. Okay? Let's read it together. Ready? Go. Peace, peace to those far and near, says the Lord, and I will heal them. But the wicked are like the tossing sea which cannot rest, whose waves cast up mire and mud. There is no peace, says my God, for the wicked. Wow. And we realize this are the very words of God. He says, if you choose to live life the way you want it, there's not going to be peace in your life. I mean, he makes it very clear. The wicked are like the tossing sea. They cannot find any rest, right? And they say there is no peace because they have dug a hole so deep that they can't get out of it. They've fallen in and they're stuck. But you know what? God can come to the rescue. Yeah, he can rescue you, but why even waste all that time, right? Digging a pit and falling into it when God says, no, you follow my ways now, you're going to experience my goodness. You're going to experience my blessings. Amen. Well, let's look at number 3 here now. How else can we make the right choices? Number 3, it says, continually surround yourself with what? Wise counsel. And think about who your friends are, all right? Look what it says here in Proverbs 13, 20 to 21. I want you to read this with me. Ready? Go. Walk with the wise and become wise. For a companion of fools suffers harm. Trouble pursues the sinner, but the righteous are rewarded with what? Good things. Wow. Okay. So once again, you got to make sure you choose wisely who your friends are. Because, you know, you heard that saying, right? Feathers. Wait. Forget that saying now. Birds of a feather, what? Flock together, right? Birds of the same feather flock together. And you become like your friends, right? If they have a greater influence over you. So that's why it's so important. You got to choose your friends wisely. Because the friends you choose, right? They can help you to grow in your faith. You know, the ones that are really godly, the ones that really love Jesus, they will help you to have a strong relationship with the Lord. You know, just imagine a beginner climber wanting to climb Mount Fuji. You guys ever seen Mount Fuji? Oh, it's spectacular. You know, when my family and I, we went to Japan. Wow, it's just like so beautiful, right? And here's the thing. Without the guidance of someone who has much experience in climbing the mountain, right, the climber is likely to make many dangerous missteps, okay? And so here's the thing, though. If you have an experienced climber, he can tell you exactly what to do. Okay, I know that this part is going to be very steep, so you got to set your footing on that stone, and then you got to put your weight down, and you got to go across this area, and you'll be safe. And then you go here, and then imagine if you have someone like that always telling you what you need to do. That's likely you're going to harm yourself or kill yourself, right? And so that's why we need to listen to the very ones, the people in our lives that they want good for you. They're not out to make your life difficult, right? They will ensure your safety. They will see to it that you're going to experience the goodness of God because they're praying for you. They're looking after you. I mean, these are the friends that are keepers, you know? And we realize, yeah, we need people in our lives that provide us the wily counsel that we need to avoid these pitfalls because, you know, Satan, he's got all these traps laid out for us. And if you got friends that are praying for you and kind of counseling you and instructing you, guess what? Less likely you're going to step into these traps. And we got to find people who are grounded in God's word and have walked a path of faith. So we got to look for like friends, family, mentors, or church members who can discern right from wrong, because they're always in the word and they take the word of God seriously. And often the people who are godly influences in our lives, they encourage us to stay the course, right? Be grounded in the word of God. They tell us to help. They tell us to find help through the power of God. And they're always instructing us in going the right direction. I mean, these are the friends that you should look for. And when we are connected to such people, we are less likely to go off course and make bad decisions that will truly mess up our lives. So if you do have a few friends like that, hey, make sure you maintain those kinds of friendships. And you know what? You be a blessing to them too. And when trouble comes in their lives, because, yeah, trouble will come to them too, you're going to be there for them. You're going to help them through it by praying for them and guiding them through the word of God. Amen? I want you to look what it says here in Proverbs 27, verse 6. I want you to read this with me. Ready? Go. Faithful are the wounds of a friend, profuse are the kisses of an enemy. Okay? Let me read it again. Faithful are the wounds of a what? Of a friend. Because you know what? Will a friend speak truth to you? Yeah. But can the truth hurt sometimes? Oh, yeah. Because sometimes they'll tell you something. Hey, you shouldn't be doing that. That is not right. That is so wrong of you to do that. And you know what? Sometimes we can get mad at our friends like that when they tell us something like that. But guess what? They care about you enough to speak what is what? What is truth? And what does this tell us here? Profuse are the kisses of an enemy. An enemy can say, I love you so much. You're the greatest person in the world. Oh, you're so wonderful. You're the best. And then they probably are laughing at you, right? As they're kissing you and telling you how wonderful you are. I mean, these are the friends you don't want, right? But we realize, yeah, true friend will always speak truth to you. And they are quick to tell you about it. You know, if you got food stuck in your teeth, you notice there's a friend that always says, hey, Ben, you got something in your teeth. You got to remove it. Well, thanks, yeah. But then there are other people, they notice there's something stuck in your teeth or maybe something hanging from your nose, right? I'm just saying. Yet what? They're just like, look at him. They're laughing. I gotta tell you, I sometimes know if this is a true friend or not. They're the first to tell me, hey, Ben, you know what? You gotta go get rid of this thing in your teeth. And I go, oh, thank you so much. And I appreciate that, right? Because guess what? We could be walking throughout the whole day. You know, we're embarrassing ourselves and no one is telling us. But a true friend won't let that happen. Amen? And you know what? These are the friends that will help us to make right decisions. They will help us to make good decisions because, you know what? They're genuine about what they say to us. Amen? Those are the kind of friends that you really want to have. Well, let's look at number four now. How else can we make the right choices? Look what it says here. It says, learn to trust God's plan over your immediate healing. And you know, a lot of times we know what God wants us to do, but you know what, sometimes our emotions can get in the way, right? The Bible says you shall know the truth and the truth shall set you free. Like, it doesn't say that it's your emotions or feelings, you know, that will be the one that will set you free, you know, because we know what God has spoken as truth, right? It is truth always. It never changes. But our emotions, can they change? At one moment, we can feel a great high. Oh, yeah, that's the one. I got to do it. Then suddenly, a few hours later, no, this is terrible. No, I shouldn't be doing this. So you know what? Our feelings and emotions are not reliable. But we know the Word of God. If you believe in it, you know it, that it won't disappoint you. It's when you trust in it, you're going to see how God's hand will move in your life. Amen? And you're going to see what God will do. With so much heart, with so much blessings that will be poured forth in your life because you're trusting in Him. I want you to read this scripture. I'm sure everyone knows this scripture. Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 through 6. Read this with me. Ready? Go. Trust in the Lord with what? All your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, submit to Him, and He will what? He will make your paths straight. And you know what? It says to trust in the Lord with some of your heart, maybe half of your heart. Is that good enough? Because why does it say all your heart? Because you know what? It really shows how much affection you have for the Lord. You believe in Him. You trust Him so much. You're not going to question Him when He speaks something into your life. Because I got to tell you, a lot of people, they question God. And I'm included, right? When I was a younger Christian, I always say, I don't know if I should do that. I know God is telling me I should forgive this person, but I'm not ready. I don't want to do that. And we know, right? When we don't trust in the Lord, that's when trouble really starts to happen in our lives. But, you know, for the person who says, Lord, I'm going to do whatever you ask, that's when you're going to experience a lot of blessings from the Lord. You know, in the 1800s, there was this famous tightrope walker. His name is Charles Blondin. I don't know if you ever heard of him, but he was very well known for his daring feats, okay? And he was particularly known for the crossings over the Niagara Falls on a tightrope. Can you imagine going over Niagara Falls on a tightrope, okay? And large crowds would gather to watch him as he would balance his way through the thundering falls. And below him was a 160-foot drop, okay? No safety nets. If he were to fall, that's the end of him, all right? But, yeah, he was bold. He was courageous, so he did it. And he just didn't just simply walk across the rope. You know what he would do? He would push a wheelbarrow across, you know, this great falls, right? And he would even be blindfolded, and he would sometimes carry items, hands. Okay, on one occasion, right, after he crossed it successfully, the crowd was in total awe. They applauded. Wow, that is so awesome. That is so spectacular. They applauded him, right? And then Blondin, he asked the crowd, hey, how many of you believe that I can push a wheelbarrow, you know, across this fall? And everyone, you know, raised their hands, said, yeah, you can do it. You can do it. They had no doubt, right? But then he asked them this question. All right, who's going to get in the wheelbarrow then? Suddenly there was great silence. No one said anything. And I said, no, really, who wants to get in the wheelbarrow? Nobody. Would you get in the wheelbarrow? Well, you believed in him. You said you trusted him. Well, guess what? Here's the thing. That's a lot of times it's the same with us and God. We say, we believe you, Lord. We trust in you. But when God says, okay, I want you to trust me with your life. Yeah, I'm asking you to do something. I know you're either going to say yes or no. A lot of people are going to not understand. A lot of people are going to say you're crazy, but this is something I want you to do. You got to entrust me with your life. And oftentimes people say, no, Lord, I can't do that. Ask me anything else. But no, I can't do that. And you know, sometimes the Lord says, no, child, you get into this wheelbarrow and you let me push it. You're going to experience the greatest blessing you'll ever experience in your life. But you got to trust in me. Sometimes we got to say, yes, Lord. We got to say, Lord, I don't understand, you know, why or what exactly you want me to do, but I'm going to trust in you. Because here's the thing, right? When we start to lose our trust in God, we're also going to start losing our faith. And when that happens, right, we're going to start to make bad decisions. We're going to start to make worldly choices. So the key is learn to trust God. When you read his word, he speaks to you about something, and you know it's deep in your heart that he wants you to do this. Say, yes, Lord, I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it with my whole heart. I'm going to believe in you. And just watch what God will do. I want you to look what it says here in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6. I want you to read it with me. Ready? Go. And without what? Without faith, it is impossible to please God. Because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists. And what? He rewards those who earnestly seek him. But you got to have faith to believe. Because faith, it goes hand in hand. When you learn to trust in God, you're going to have greater faith in him also. Because you realize there's nothing that is impossible with God. And so when you believe in him, wow, God knows this. He looks right in your heart. You say, yeah, my child really believes in me. Okay, here is this great miracle that my child has been desiring. And I got to tell you, it's going to be beyond what you ever expected. It's going to be even greater because you had the faith to trust in him, to believe in him. I got to tell you, it is so awesome when we can go to God and say, Lord, there is nothing that is impossible with you. Amen? And the last one here, how can we make right choices? Well, look what it says there. We must learn from what? Past mistakes and grow. Look what Paul says here in Philippians chapter 3, verses 13 to 14. I want you to read it with me. Ready? Go. Brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it. But one thing I do, forgetting what is what? Behind and straining toward what is ahead, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. I got to tell you, it's just like driving a car, right? Where's your focus when you're driving a car? Are you looking straight ahead? You should, right? Your focus is on the road ahead. But there are times we glance in our rearview mirror. Why do we do that? Because we got to see what is behind. Behind us, okay? And here's the thing. Just imagine if I told you, okay, you can drive my car, but you only can look in the rearview mirror. Would you do it? Because what's going to happen to you if you start going forward and you only can look at your rearview mirror? Oh, you're going to get in one quick accident, you know, in no time, right? And we know, right? Some people, they do that. They keep looking behind. They're looking what has happened in their lives. They keep looking to the past. And guess what? They cannot move forward with the Lord because fear has gripped their minds and hearts. They keep looking in the past and say, oh, you don't know what happened to me. I hear that a lot. Pastor, you don't know what happened to me. That's why I cannot do that. I cannot serve in this ministry. No, it hurts too much. No, my past, I mean, it has paralyzed me. And I go, yeah, that's what has happened. We got to stop doing that. Because guess what? You're showing to God, hey, I don't trust you. This is what you allowed to happen in my past, Lord. So I don't want that to happen again. Well, did you really believe the Lord made that happen? Or did you allow that to happen in your life? You know, that you were the one that was responsible for what had taken place. And you know, our past mistakes can teach us valuable lessons, but we shouldn't dwell on them. Because, yeah, I've seen it too many times. People are paralyzed. They can't move forward because of the mistakes they had done in the past. You know, instead, we can learn from them and we can choose to make better choices as we continually move forward with God. Amen? And that's why it's so important that we do not allow ourselves to be frozen right where we are because of the mistakes we made in the past. I got to tell you, in this little village, right, two brothers, they were convicted of stealing sheep, okay? For their crime, the mayor decided that they would be branded on their forehead, okay? I know, it sounds terrible, right? They would be branded on their forehead with the letters ST. And ST means sheep thief, all right? And so one brother, right, he was like totally anguished, you know, when this happened. And he decided he would run away to another country. And he said, I'm going to build a new life. But you know what? It was just too difficult because people would ask him, hey, how come you got ST on your forehead, right? And you know, he would try to think of something to say, but, you know, it just was so embarrassing to him. And he was so filled with so much shame that he said, you know what, I can't take this anymore. So he took his own life, all right? He committed suicide, okay? But the other brother, he took a different approach. He said to himself, you know, I can't run away from the fact that I stole sheep, but, you know, the past is the past. You know, I can stay here and win back my self-respect and the respect of my neighbor. So you know what? He lived a life full of integrity. He even came to know Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior. And he built a reputation for integrity. And you know, one day, a stranger, right, saw this brother. And now he's an old man. I mean, years have passed, maybe 20, 30 years, right? And this stranger who happened to be in the town, right, saw this old man, right? And he saw the letters ST written on his forehead. So he asked one of the residents, hey, what is that all about? Why does he have the letters ST on his head? Well, you know what the resident said? You know what? It happened a long time ago. I've forgotten the particulars about this. But I think the letters are an abbreviation for saint. S-T, saint. And you know what? Yeah, we all have past. I have a past that I'm not too proud of. But guess what? You are a new creation in Jesus Christ. Amen? The old has gone. The new has come. And as you trust in Jesus, as you express your love, your affection to him each and every day, as you desire his word more than anything in this life, just watch the goodness of God coming forth in your life. Amen? You're going to see the power of God being displayed in your life as you live a life that is fully submitted to him. Amen? And that's what it's all about, brothers and sisters. You got to trust in him, believe in him with your whole heart. I want you to take a look at the bottom line verses now. You know, I got to tell you, you know, in 2008, right, my family and I, we moved into our new home. And we have a pretty big yard, right? So, you know, I decided, you know what, I'm going to take care of the yard myself. So I bought a weed whacker and a lawnmower combo from Home Depot, okay? It was a sale, all right? I think it was like $159 for two. That's a pretty good deal, yeah, in 2008 for a lawnmower and a weed whacker. Well, you know, I said, okay, I'm going to do this, right? But I took it home, and I used the weed whacker, and it seemed to work pretty good. So I just kind of like did my own, you know, yard lawn, right? And I kind of just put the lawnmower on the side because, yeah, this weed whacker, it does a good enough job. And, you know, the lawnmower is electric. So, you know, you got to plug it in, long wire. And so I just kind of, I just used the weed whacker. But you know what happened? My weed whacker broke. Okay, and you know, at first I was like, oh, should I get a new one? But I said, I don't want to use that lawnmower because, you know, I got to, you know, plug it into a, you know, outlet and all that. And so, you know what? We decided, okay, we're going to hire a yard man to do all this, right? And so, you know what happened? Just recently, you know, I think it was like last year, right? You know, I told my wife, hey, you know what? I think I want to try and kind of like take care of the yard myself again, right? And this time I got my son who's old enough to help me, right? And so I said, okay, well, let's try that. So I got an electric one, and then I got a battery-operated one. And you know, me and my son, would take about an hour to cut the grass, right? And then just a few weeks ago, actually, my son said, hey, Dad, I think, you know, it'd be a lot easier if maybe we got a lawnmower. And then I told him, man, you know what? I think we have one somewhere close to our house. I think it's on the side of the house. And I never touched it. I actually let it sit there from 2008. It's been sitting there, wasn't plugged in, hasn't been used. But I said, I think it might work. I don't know. And because, you know, it has been like all this time, right? We've been using the weed whacker. But we've seen other neighbors using their lawnmower, and it seems like it works pretty good, right? I mean, it cuts the grass really well. So, you know, we plugged it in, and guess what? It works! And we're like, oh, praise God, right? And we're like, wow, this is cool. And we're like, and then we realized we got it done in like 20, 25 minutes. Normally, it would take over an hour with just the weed whacker. And it just dawned on me. We had something so good that we never used it. God had blessed us with this thing. And why haven't we used it? That was like what? 16, 17 years ago, right? It just sat there unused. And so my son and I, okay, we're going to use this every time now, right? But we realized, this is what I learned. God has given us exactly what we need. Sometimes we complain, but God, I don't have this. I don't have that. But God says, no, you have it. You're not using it. What we got to realize is that God has given us his wisdom. A lot of times we make wrong choices because even though his wisdom is for our access all the time, right? He gives us an abundance of his wisdom. We don't use it because guess what? Want to do things our way. We go to our family, we go to our friends, we go to everybody else except God. And God says, how come you don't come to me, child? I got a load of wisdom to download into your mind and into your heart if you only come to me. That's what we realize. We got to go to him. We cannot forget that God can give us wisdom and that we will make good choices, not just good choices, awesome choices, if we learn to listen for his voice and do as his word tells us. I want you to look at what it says here in Jeremiah 33, verses 2 to 3. And this is the last scripture here. Read this with me. Ready? Go. Thus says the Lord who made the earth, the Lord who formed it to establish it. The Lord is his name. What does he say? Call to me and I will what? I will answer you, and I will tell you great and what? hidden things that you have not known. So what do we got to do? We just got to call to him. And, you know, call him simply means to go to his word and say, Lord, I'm hungry for your wisdom. Lord, speak to me because I'm very confused right now. I don't know what to do. And, you know, even with the election coming up, you know, I know who I voted for. But if you're still kind of like, oh, I don't know, you know what? Go to the Holy Spirit because it should be plain and clear who you are to vote for, as the Holy Spirit will show it to you. You got to go to the one that you know that is, you know, holding on to the very principles of God. You want a candidate that will choose the ways of God. But, you know, it tells us as we call on him, he will tell you great and hidden things. Because you know what? It could have been that it was once hidden, right? Just like my lawnmower was hidden on the side of my house, right? When you call on him, guess what? It is no longer hidden. He's going to reveal to you what is truth. And suddenly you go, wow, how come I didn't go to God sooner? If I went to him sooner, I wouldn't still be in this mess that I am in. So we got to learn to do this, brothers and sisters. We got to learn to go to him. Call on him, and he will answer you. And he will tell you great and hidden things that you have not known. Amen? Praise God. Why don't we go ahead, let's bow our heads, let's bow our hearts. Let's come before our Lord Jesus Christ. Father God, we just want to thank you, Lord, for the message spoken today. And Father, we want to make wise decisions in our lives. We want to make the right choices. We want to make the choices that will bring forth your goodness. And Father, we know you have given us your word. You have given us the Bible so that we will know how to live our lives that are truly blessed by you as we choose to do things your way. And right now, with all our heads bowed, with our eyes closed, you may be saying, you know, Pastor Ben, I can see it. After listening to this message today, I realize that even though I am a Christian, I realize I don't go to God as often as I should. I make choices sometimes based on my own instincts. Sometimes I make choices based on what my friends or family have told me. But I never go to the Holy Spirit. I never go to God. Well, let me tell you, brothers and sisters, about time you did. Because I'm telling you, he is real. You know, I've been walking with the Lord for over 30 years. And the more I draw close to him, it's not like, oh, I'm already there. No, every day I desire him. I seek his counsel. I seek his wisdom. And let me tell you, he never disappoints. And right now, if that's your heart, you're saying, Lord, sorry. I'm so sorry I haven't gone to you. I haven't seek your wisdom. I haven't seek your counsel. But from this day forward, I'm going to look to you. I'm going to trust in you. And I'm going to see your goodness coming forth in my life as I continue to live my life for you. And if this is the cry of your heart, with all our heads bowed, with our eyes closed, you're saying, Lord, I desire you. Can you raise your hand right now and say, that's me, so I can pray for you. Praise God. Praise God. Anyone else saying, Lord, I'm living for you. I'm trusting in you with all my heart. I want you to be my all in all in my life. Praise God. Praise God. Anyone else? Anyone else? Thank you, Jesus. I see your hand. I see your hand. All right. You can put your hands down. Praise God. Father, you've seen all the hands that were raised, but more importantly, is the heart behind those hands saying, Lord, I'm going to live my life for you. I'm going to make decisions based according to what your scriptures, what your word have been revealed to me. I'm going to do things your way. Father, as my brothers and sisters have this kind of heart, I pray that showers of blessings will be poured forth upon their lives. They're going to see, Lord, all their problems, all their difficulties will just become less and less as you will take care of it, as you will be the one to show them what they need to do to totally eradicate it. Father, I thank you, Lord, knowing that you love us so much. This is what you're willing to do. We just want to tell you how much we love you and how much we praise you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Now, for some of you, you may be saying, you know, Pastor Ben, I've heard pastors give this invitation to receive Jesus Christ into my life. But to be honest, I've been putting it off. I say, okay, maybe not today, maybe tomorrow, maybe next week, maybe next month, maybe next year. I'm not ready right now. You know, the Bible says today is the day of salvation. Why would you want to wait, knowing that the Lord God wants you to be received into His family right now? Today. Because this is going to be the most eternal decision you have ever made. Because if you know with certainty that Jesus Christ is in your life, that you come to know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, guess what? You know, if you were to take your last and final breath on this planet Earth, you're going to be ushered into the holy presence of God. But you must accept His Son, Jesus, today. You must know Him before you can be allowed in to this place of great peace, great love, great joy. Right now, if this is your heart's desire, you know, this is something you got to choose to do. If you haven't received Christ, don't wait any longer. Saying, yes, Lord, I submit my life to You. And if this is your heart's cry, can you just raise your hand and say, that's me. I choose Jesus. I receive Him into my life. Praise God. Anyone else saying yes to Jesus Christ? Praise God. I see your hand. I see your hand. I see your hand. Praise God. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. All right, you can put your hands down. I want you to pray this prayer with me. I want you to pray it out loud. Pray it from your heart. Because I guarantee you, God is listening right now. And if you welcome Him into your life, I'm going to tell you, you're going to see how your life will change. God will take a hold of your life, and He will bring forth His goodness into your life. Just repeat these very words after me. Say, Father God, I need You. I give You praise for who You are. I believe in You.
I believe in
Your Son, Jesus Christ.
I believe in Your Son, Jesus Christ.
Who died for me on the cross.
Who died for me on the cross.
But on the third day,
He rose again.
And He lives inside of my heart. I give You praise for that. And Father God, I confess that I'm a sinner. But Your word says, if I confess of my sins, You are faithful and just to forgive me of my sins and cleanse me from all unrighteousness. Cleanse me now, Lord. And make me holy and pure unto You. So now I say this. So you can hear me, Father God. So that everyone can hear me. So that I can hear myself. And so that the devil will know that Jesus Christ is my Lord. I live for Him. I live for Him only. Father God, I thank You for You have written my name in Your Lamb's Book of Life. And I'll spend eternity with You forever. It's in Jesus' name I pray. And everyone says, Amen. Praise God. Praise God. Let's give Him a clap.